So basically, thank you for the kind introduction. I will repeat that I'm Athanasia Kazantzi. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the National Technical University of Athens. And what I'm actually going to present today is the research work that I'm conducting for about a year and a half in collaboration with Dr. Dimitrios Vambatzikos, again from the National Technical University of Athens. And it is actually related to the analytical vulnerability assessment of building classes for the global earthquake model. Actually, this is a grant effort for producing an open source tool for large scale loss assessment studies. So before to proceed with the core of this presentation, I think that it is useful to outline its content. So I'm going first of all to define what the seismic vulnerability for single buildings and building classes is. Then we are going to see how an entire building inventory can be represented with a set of building classes. And after that, we are going to see how a particular building class can be represented with a specific number of characteristic buildings, which are called index buildings. And once we've done that, covering the theoretical background of an analytical vulnerability assessment, we will see a case study that actually involves reinforced concrete high-rise buildings, and we will see the details of this methodology and how we can proceed with vulnerability assessment. And on top of that, we will discuss the important issue of selecting a sufficient intensity measure for the entire building class. This is actually quite a challenging topic that so far hasn't been studied satisfactorily. So let's first see what the seismic vulnerability assessment is. When we are performing a seismic vulnerability assessment, what we are trying actually to do is to provide the probability of damage for a structural type given a seismic scenario. And as you may understand, this is quite an important ingredient in any loss assessment study, in the sense that actually we should take great care when we are performing this, when we are taking this step, because any errors associated with this process cascade down to the evaluation of losses. So we should execute this particular process with great care. Now, the seismic vulnerability assessment may be evaluated either for individual buildings, which is actually the simplest case, or for an entire building class, which, as we will see, is a slightly more complicated process. But the tools as engineers that we have whenever we want to undertake a seismic vulnerability assessment is to adopt either empirical methodologies, analytical methodologies, or we can base these assessments only on expert opinion. But actually, as you may understand, as we go down this list, the credibility of the methodology is being reduced. So the optimum case is to adopt empirical methodologies to perform a seismic vulnerability assessment. Now, to give you an example of the difference between actually undertaking a vulnerability assessment for a building population and a single building, I'm presenting here two figures, one showing a single building and another one showing an entire building inventory. And you may think that actually we can perform the vulnerability assessment for the building population by adopting identical methodologies to those adopted for single buildings. But actually, if you try to do so, you will find yourself having to assess the vulnerability of every single building within this large population and end up with more or less a never-ending process, a time-consuming process, but is it that is impractical in terms of the invested time and effort. So basically, it becomes apparent that whenever we are dealing with a building population, with a building inventory, we can use similar tools than those which we were using for single building cases, but we really need to somehow simplify the process in order to end up with a procedure that can be that can have some practical value. Now, before to proceed with explaining the this methodology, I think that it is useful to know who is interested in this information. Quite surprisingly, there are several parties that are interested in knowing the vulnerability as the seismic vulnerability of a building class, including the emergency management agencies who actually use this information to be better prepared for future earthquake events. Then it comes the insurance companies, which are very much interested in this information so as to more accurately evaluate the insurance premiums and reduce the potential economic losses and future earthquake events. And then it comes the building owners and the structural or earthquake engineers, who based on this information they can actually know the potential losses in future earthquake events, or they can use also this data for improving their future seismic designs. Now let's see where we stand at the moment on this issue. Actually, I've already told you that the empirical methodologies are the preferable ones in terms of being the most credible methodology that we can actually adopt. So one may think that we can always adopt empirical methodologies whenever it comes to assess the seismic vulnerability of a building class, but unfortunately, this is not the case, because actually there is a lack of sufficient historical data for the several building classes that can be found across the globe. So here is where the analytical methodologies come into play in order to fill this gap of the insufficient historical data. But still, despite the recent advances in this field, there are several unresolved issues with respect to the loss assessment of building classes, which need to be treated properly in order to be able later on to proceed with confidence in the vulnerability assessment of a building class. So what it was actually employed within the auspices of the Global Earthquake Model is actually a practical methodology that it is based on the ATC 58 document. This is actually a document that was only recently released in 2012, and it provides a methodology for performing an analytical seismic vulnerability assessment for building classes. So the GEM, the Global Earthquake Model, adopted this sort of methodology, but we have tried actually to simplify it a little bit, this methodology, by accounting for what we call the top damageable components in order to evaluate the seismic losses. And this is actually means that instead of assessing the losses of every single element within the structure, we consider the top damageable components in the sense that these are actually the components that contribute most to the construction cost new of the structure, and then we have proceeded with adopting this practical ATC 58 methodology. And on top of that, we have actually examined and proposed a methodology for checking locally the efficiency of several intensity measures for the entire building class. And this is actually a research study that was done almost for the first time in the research field. So let's begin first with defining what a building class is. as I already told you, in large areas, we cannot just go down to the entire building inventory and assess the vulnerability of each individual building, because this process is really time consuming and is inappropriate for practical applications. So what we are actually doing in these cases is that we classify the building within the building inventory on the basis of a few characteristic parameters like their height, their material of construction, their use, the year of construction, etc. And on the basis of these characteristics, we are identifying within the building inventory of interest different building classes or different subclasses of buildings which have some common features, and then we proceed in this process with representing the several building classes, each one of these building classes with a set of index buildings. Now, to clarify further this process, let's consider the building inventory in the municipality of Thessaloniki. Actually, this is a study that was performed by Professor Pitilakis and Argyrodis. And actually, it was found that the building inventory in the municipality of Thessaloniki, it consists of about 20,000 buildings, of which about 26,000 are reinforced concrete buildings and about 2,000 are masonry buildings. And what we have tried to do actually is to classify the reinforced concrete buildings and the masonry buildings and some subclasses depending on a number of characteristic features that these buildings have. So in fact, for the reinforced concrete buildings, we may identify three different subclasses depending first of all on the structural type. So we can have reinforced concrete buildings with infill panels, reinforced concrete buildings with open ground spaces, and reinforced concrete building with dual lateral load resisting systems. We can also identify within this building inventory buildings that were designed based on a different seismic code, and also we can identify three different subcategories within the reinforced concrete buildings depending on their height. So we had low, medium, and high-rise buildings. Now, almost the same procedure was followed for the masonry buildings, in which case we can identify two different subcategories, one that accounts for the rigidity of the floor diaphragm in these buildings. So we can have masonry buildings with flexible diaphragms and masonry buildings with rigid diaphragms. And again, depending on their building height, we can have low or medium rise buildings. Now, by considering these subclasses, we can now divide this building inventory into a number of subclasses. For instance, in the case of reinforced concrete buildings, we can identify a subclass that contains, for instance, high-rise buildings with an open ground space that were designed according to Eurocodade. Or if we consider the masonry buildings, we can identify medium-rise buildings with either flexible or rigid diaphragm. So what we have actually done here is that we took a building inventory that contains buildings with different characteristics, and we split it into different subclasses, building classes that contain buildings with common features. And this is actually the process for that we need to follow whenever we have a building inventory and we need to categorize the buildings inside this building inventory into different building classes. Now, once we identify these different subclasses within this inventory, then we need to proceed with actually representing each one of these class with a set of index buildings. And here we have again three options. One, to characterize the entire building class with just one index buildings, which is considered to be either the median or the typical case. And actually this is, as you may understand, the simplest representation of any building class. Then we can use three index buildings for representing the building class, and these are actually three index buildings which are equally weighted and were deemed to represent the poor, the typical, and the superior case. Or alternatively, we can adopt a methodology which is called moment matching in order to identify 2k plus 1 index buildings, with k being the number of the characteristic features of the buildings within the building class in question. Now, to expand a little bit further on the moment matching algorithm, which is actually the most, say, accurate procedure for identifying the index buildings that represent the building class. This is actually an algorithmic procedure to determine a set of 2k plus 1 index buildings, in which the mean and the standard deviation of the population properties are being condensed to a number of index buildings. So as one building always represents the center of the building population, while two more are required to define the properties of each one of the k features. And at the end of this moment matching process, each one of these index buildings was assigned a weight. So in this particular process, the buildings, the index buildings are not equally weighted within this population, but each building was assigned a weight so as to represent its membership and the actual building population. Now, for our case study, which actually was based on a building inventory that consisted of 263 high-rise reinforced concrete buildings that were designed for high seismicity US regions, we have identified four key features within this building class, this being the height, the vertical irregularity ratio, the plan irregularity ratio, and the design base shear. And for identifying the index buildings, in order to characterize this building class, we have adopted the moment matching algorithm, which we've seen before. And on the basis of this process, we actually found out that the plan irregularity ratio has an insignificant effect. So we disregarded it, and then we ended up with three key features that resulted in seven index buildings in order to represent this particular building class, with the height ranging from 7 to 20 stories. And each one of these index buildings was assigned a particular weight so as to reflect its membership in the actual population. Now, to summarize the results of this process, you can see the 70 index buildings that we have actually defined in order to represent the building class equation, which is actually a high-rise reinforced concrete building class. And you can see that actually we have seven index buildings, of which number one is actually the center of our population, with all its key features being assigned their mean value. And you can see in the last column the weight that was obtained using the moment matching algorithm, and that number actually accounts for the significance, the contribution of each one of these of the index buildings and inside the building class in question. Now, once we identify the index buildings, the next step to do is to actually model these index buildings in order to be able later on to evaluate the structural response. Again, In this process, we have three main options depending on the level of complexity which we can tolerate in the process of our seismic loss assessment. So we can actually have level A, level B, and level C modeling. Level A involves multi-degree of freedom system, which can either be two-dimensional or three-dimensional, and it is actually the highest level of complexity that we can have in our problem. Then it comes the level B choice of model complexity, in which case we reduce the multi-degree of freedom systems into what we call stick models. Actually, in these stick models, the properties of each floor are being condensed to a single column and a single spring element. And then it comes the simplest representation, which is the level C modeling, which involves nonlinear single degree of freedom systems. But as you may understand, this is only applicable in case of first mode dominated structure. So basically, what we need to sort in this level is for the minimum required level of complexity, since we need to evaluate the response of several index buildings. But we need to keep in mind that our model should be accurate enough so as to be able later on to provide reasonable response estimates for the buildings in question. Now, for our particular building case that involves high-rise buildings, we have used the level A modeling, so we have modeled our index buildings using multi-degree of freedom systems. But since we found that the plan irregularity was insignificant, we have adopted two-dimensional models. And you can see here that actually the perimeter reinforced concrete high-rise frames were modeled like this, including a leaning column, in order to account for the destabilizing P delta effects that are associated with the gravity loads that were carried by the internal gravity frames of our structures. And when it comes to modeling the structural elements, we have choose the plastic hinge option. So we have modeled the structural elements with lamp plasticity elements, which have their properties evaluated from empirical actuations that were proposed by Panagiotakos and Fardias in 2008 for reinforced concrete structural members. And you can see here the adopted backbone for our plastic hinges, in which the yield moment, the yield rotation, and the cupping rotation, which is actually a rotation beyond which we have a significant strength loss, were evaluated on the basis on the empirical equations that were proposed by Panagiotakos and Fardis. And actually similar expressions were adopted also by Eurocode 8. Now, when it comes to evaluate the response of our structural models, we actually have different options, but the favorite options of our research team, for the obvious reason, is to use the incremental dynamic analysis that was proposed in 2002 by Vambatsikos and Cornell. And actually, Professor Adam before gave you a very detailed presentation of how to perform an incremental dynamic analysis, what steps are being involved, and how you can then end up with an incremental dynamic analysis here. Now, the first thing, of course, that you need in this process is to define your structural model, so decide the level of complexity that you need in terms of the structural model, and build up your numerical model. Then you need to select a set of ground motion records, and I really agree with Professor Adam that we need a large number of records in order to end up with a reasonable response estimates. And then we scale this set of records so as to cover the entire structural response. So we scale the accelerograms to increasing intensity levels, so as to be able while we perform the dynamic analysis, to actually reveal entire response of our structural system from elasticity up to global collapse. And then what we have to do in this process is to record the structural response, or alternatively to plot an engineering demand parameter against an intensity measure level, and then by connecting these points we end up with an IDA curve that corresponds to a particular record. And if we are consider a sufficient number of records, we end up with several IDA curves that will then help us to evaluate the mean and the standard deviation of the response of our system with some confidence. So here is an example of a structural system that was analyzed using 60 different ground motion records. And here you can see that what we have plotted is the maximum interstory drift ratio of this building. So this is our engineering demand parameter for this case study. And here we have as an intensity measure the first mode spectral acceleration of the building, and the different color lines, the different color IDA curves correspond to the different ground motion records that we have used for our dynamic analysis. And what it is notable actually here is that the record-to-record variability, the response that we get for the same system which we analyze under different ground motion records is very significant. So in order to get a more clear picture of this system, what we need to do as a next step is to summarize design IDA curves using what we called counted statistic, or counted fractile curves. And we end up with these three fractile curves with the blue line showing the median IDA curve for this particular system. Now, in terms of the complexity of the methodology that we are using to evaluate the structural response, of course the full IDA option is the most accurate one, but it also comes with the cost of needing more time to pre and post process the result. So we may consider other type of methodologies, like the simplified IDA methodology, which involves actually analyzing our structural system, our MDOF system, through a nonlinear static pushover analysis using several lateral load patterns in order to identify the worst possible collapse mechanism. And then based on this information, we can define an equivalent single degree of freedom system and proceed with this system on evaluating using either empirical equations or the SPO2 IDA tool that was proposed by Vambatsikos and Cornell in 2006, evaluate the approximate IDA curves. Now, in the case, in our case study, which we had to deal with high-rise reinforced concrete buildings, we have found actually that this methodology, in some cases, resulted in a seismic response estimates that were of non-acceptable accuracy for the obvious reason that actually high-rise buildings have a very high contribution of higher modes, so it was impossible for this simplified methodology to capture the effect of the higher mode, so we didn't consider these simplified methodologies. But in other cases, in other building classes that involve lower buildings, where the structures are mostly first mode dominated, this procedure can result in findings and results of acceptable accuracy within a fraction of time required to perform a full IDA analysis. So for the reasons that I have discussed before, in this particular case study, we have adopted the full IDA methodology using 22 ground motion records having two components each. That results in 44 ground motion records for running our nonlinear dynamic analysis. And for defining the IDA curves for through this process, we have selected an intensity measure, which we will see later on what sort of challenges this process involves, and an engineering demand parameter, which in our case was the interstory drift ratio and the peak floor acceleration evaluated at each story and each floor respectively. Since later on in the loss assessment process, what we need to do is to evaluate damages in both drift and acceleration sensitive components. So we needed we need to record the response, the drift response, along with the acceleration response of the system. And these are the response spectra of the unscaled ground motion records that we have used in the IDA methodologies. And what we actually got in terms of the system response were IDA fractile curves like those presented in this figure for two characteristic index buildings. So the first one corresponds to the number 1 7 story building, and the second one corresponds to the number 2 20 story index buildings. And once we finish with evaluating the structural response, we can now proceed with applying the ADC58 component-based vulnerability approach. Actually, I don't have the time to discuss all the details of these procedures, but you may refer to this document if you want to see the details of these methodologies. In fact, what we have evaluated based only on the damages associated with what we call the top structural and non-structural components, where the where vulnerability functions for each one of the index buildings which look like this. So each one of these color lines represent the fragility function for one index building. So we have seven vulnerability functions for the seven index buildings that we have actually used in order to represent our building class. And then by considering the weight that was assigned in each one of these index buildings in the moment matching algorithm step, we have produced here the vulnerability function for the entire building class, which is presented here with a thick black line. Now, one notable thing in this process is actually the intensity measure that is being used in order to present our index building fragility functions, vulnerability functions. So you can see that in order to be able later on to combine the results of this process and end up with the vulnerability function of the entire class, what we need to do is to express the vulnerability of our index buildings using a common intensity measure. And this is actually a point that it's really different from what we are actually doing when we are performing a vulnerability vulnerability assessment for an individual building. So we need to express the results against a common intensity measure in order to be able later on to combine them and end up compute the vulnerability of the entire building class. And here you can see that as a first initial guess, we have used the as a common intensity measure the spectral acceleration evaluated at an arbitrary period of 1 second. However, as you may understand, this choice is not the optimum one in terms of its efficiency. So what we have done actually in this study is we have tried to explore a little bit further this intensity measure challenge, which is actually the challenge of expressing all the results against a common intensity measure that needs to be remain efficient and sufficient for the entire building class. Now, to do so, what we have done is that we have explored the sufficiency and efficiency of seven different common intensity measure, and we have checked this efficiency and sufficiency across the entire building class. So the intensity measures, the different intensity measures that we have considered within this study was first of all the spectral acceleration evaluated at a period of 1 second. And in fact, I have to say that we didn't expect much from this intensity measure. And the only reason for its inclusion is that up until now, this is a common choice when it comes to the vulnerability assessment of building classes. Then we have considered the spectral acceleration evaluated at the mean first mode period of all index buildings. And then we have considered 5 more intensity measures which were evaluated as the geometric mean of the spectral acceleration evaluated across several period ranges. Now I have to say actually that the geometric mean choice didn't came out of the blue in our mind. Actually, quite a few researchers, including Professor Adam and his research team, have done a lot of work on the geometric mean intensity measures. But what was actually novel in this study is that for the first time we have tested the efficiency of these intensity measures for the entire building class. In terms of the geometric mean intensity measures, these are the 5 period ranges that we have considered. Actually, you can see that these period ranges range from the mean second mode period of all index buildings up to an elongated version of the mean first mode period of our index buildings in an attempt to capture first of all the higher mode effect as well as the period elongation that occurs in our structural models as we have the spread of inelasticity in them. One last thing for checking the intensity measure, the efficiency of the intensity measure that we have considered in this study is actually the fact that we have performed this test on what we called an intensity measure given an engineering demand parameter basis. This is actually, if you want to visualize this, is equivalent to drawing a vertical line across the space defined from our IDA curves and actually identify the points where this line that begins from a particular engineering demand parameter level crosses the IDA curves. And that defines these points, which are called intensity measure capacity points. And then by evaluating the dispersion of these intensity measure capacity points at different level or a different level of engineering demand parameters, we can assess the efficiency of the considered intensity measure. This is actually quite different from what it is done by other researchers in the past who perform the check on an engineering demand given an intensity measure level. And the apparent advantage of the selected choice is that actually we can follow the structural response up to the global collapse, whereas in the case that we are performing the check on an engineering demand parameter basis, given an intensity measure, we need to stay away from the global collapse state, since in these cases the seismic response becomes infinite. So through this process, what we got is figures like that for each one of the index buildings. So I'm just presenting the result for one index building, but actually similar figures were obtained for all seven buildings that we have considered for our reinforced concrete high-rise building class. And what we can actually see here is that the geometric intensity measure, which are here, which are defined at appropriate period ranges, are rather efficient compared to the other common choices, like the spectral acceleration evaluated at a period of 1 second, that we can see with the red line here. And you can see that the dispersion associated with this choice is much higher compared to the dispersion associated with the dispersion with the geometric mean intensity measure choices. And this applies both to interstory drift ratio and peak floor acceleration engineering demand parameters. And that means that we have actually managed to verify the efficiency of this intensity measure across the entire response range, both for the interstory drift ratio and the peak floor acceleration. Hence we can use with confidence this intensity measure in loss assessment studies that involved a building class. Of course, future research is anticipated to shed more light on this issue, but what we have actually managed to do here is to end up with a methodology that can be easily used by engineers that are involved in loss assessment studies in order to check the efficiency of the selected intensity measure. Now, ongoing research on this issue, which is not related so far to the building classes, is to actually combine the significant duration with the geometric mean intensity measures. And so far what we have found by testing a single capacity design steel moment resisting frame under 76 long and short duration records is that actually combining geometric mean intensity measures with the significant duration of the ground motion can reduce the dispersion in high response level associated with the collapse. So this addition can add value to the collapse vulnerability studies. But actually, for the lower response values, you can see that this addition does not add much. So basically, there is no need in including the significant duration in loss assessment studies of modern buildings, where most of the losses occur well before the collapse state of our structural system. Now, to sum up, what I have presented here is a practical vulnerability methodology that was adopted by the Global Earthquake Model for building classes, and actually this is based on what was proposed by the ATC 58 document, with the only difference that instead of accounting for every single element within the structure, we have accounted only for what we have called the top damageable components. And also on that basis, we have developed a methodology for checking locally the efficiency of different intensity measures that can be used across an entire building class. And finally, we've seen whether or not the addition of the significant duration can add value to the problem of the intensity measure selection. And actually, that concludes my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for a thorough presentation. If there are any questions, please ask. Yes.
You mentioned this weighting factor,
in the moment matching algorithm, you mean?
Yeah, it was mentioned on slide 13 somewhere, yeah, in your table, and later you took it up again.
Yes.
Could you?
Do you want to see the table?
No, I just want to have a sort of explanation how you compute this.
It's actually, you have to apply the this algorithmic process, the moment matching algorithm, which assigned a weight to this index building, to each one of the index buildings, and try to match the standard deviation and the mean of the entire population with the key features of the index buildings in question. So it's an algorithmic procedure based on an iterative process with which you can match the standard deviation of the population with the individual features of the index buildings.
Okay, and it means the sum of all weighting factors for one population would be one.
Yeah.
And it means as soon as you let's say investigate more buildings of the same kind, then you would have to recalculate all those weighting factors.
If you consider more index buildings, then you have to, yes, recalculate the weight factor of these buildings.
Yeah. I have a question. Page 30 in your presentation. 30 or 31.
Is that one?
30.
Oh, 30. This one?
No, I think it's 4. Yes, this one.
Yeah.
There comes this peak in the presentation of the peak for acceleration.
In this, yes, here this one, yeah. Yeah, actually this where we were, you can see here that actually this is just the maximum dispersion. So what we are recording here is the maximum dispersion that we are observing inside the building.
Yes.
So basically this is this we think that it is just a local thing, because if you see the average dispersion for our index buildings, then we don't have this peak dispersion. So it's more likely associated with the higher mode effect that comes into play as the structure proceeds from elasticity to yielding. But it's just a local effect. It doesn't appear in the average dispersion of the intensity measures. So it just appears in one floor.
Okay.